Good morning. Welcome to worship on this World Communion Sunday. We are happy that you are here with us, whether you're watching online or here in person. Welcome. I invite you to join me now in our call to worship in the bolded parts printed in your bulletin. In your wisdom, O God, you call us here to worship you. We gather alive to the word of God. You call us to be fully alive with your life abundant, ready to listen and respond with heart, soul, strength, and mind. We listen alive to the word of God. You call us to be always watchful for your word of wisdom, always dwelling among us. We watch and wait for the word of God. You may be seated. We are called to confess before God so that we might come to the word of the Lord with open ears and minds. I invite you to join me in our communal prayer of confession in your bulletin. Loving God, you created us to live in relationship with you, to love and serve one another, and to care for all your creatures. Yet in the hardness of our hearts, we dismiss your commandments and seek to go our separate ways. Lord, have mercy on us. Redeem, restore, and recreate us for the sake of Christ our Savior. Amen. In this time of silence, let's confess our hearts before God. What are we that God is mindful of us? Who are we that God should care for us? Yet God now calls us beloved children. Jesus now claims us as siblings. This is the good news of God's grace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As Christ has shown us peace, I now invite you to share a sign of that peace with one another. Welcome one another in a pandemically mindful way. You can bow or give an air high five or curtsy, however you might like to greet those around you. But let us welcome one another with a sign of Christ's peace.
Check, I am on. Okay, so for the time, for the child inside all of us, I just have a few quick questions. Does anyone notice anything different about the sanctuary today? Yeah, any one of you?
Lots and lots of flags and bread and cups.
What's that about? Yeah. It changed to red? That's good. Very good observation, yeah. We got a lot going on here today. Does anyone know what the flags mean, or would anyone be willing to shout it out? World Communion Sunday. World Communion Sunday. And we're going to talk about World Communion Sunday in just a second. But the first question that I have is, Pastor Sarah, what's your favorite flag that's hanging up here?
That's a great question.
Besides the American flag, I'll let you off the hook.
Okay.
There, okay?
Yeah, thank you. Now, are we talking design? Are
design,
we talking?
Which is the prettiest, okay. Which you think is the coolest?
Well, I love this one that I happen to know is from Canada because it has a leaf on it.
Oh, that's really great.
What's your favorite one?
I think my favorite one is the Japanese flag over here,
ooh,
I think.
Because
I
okay.
love the little stripy symbols on the outside.
Is that Japan or is that
Japan
one?
Or is that
Japan?
Which one is that? Do you know? Or Japan's right there, yeah.
Yeah,
so
you're
which,
right.
Does anyone know which one this one is? China? Korea? Is it Korea? We're here in Korea, yeah. Wow. So the Korean flag, I guess.
We have a quiz after the service,
yeah.
So study up.
Yeah, you know how well I did in geography, so. do others want to shout out? What are your favorites that you see around here? Yeah.
My favorite is
it's the Japan flag, the one back there with the red circle. Yeah, that is a really
cool
one, isn't it? Yeah, which one's your favorite?
I like the one with the moon and the star.
The one with the moon and the star.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, that is really. Is that Turkey? Is that right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, what's your favorite? Yeah, and I believe that's Greece. Am I doing all right on that? Yeah, Kate. Sorry, can you shout that out?
United
The United Nations flag, yeah. Yes. Oh, I love that. All right, and I saw a hand over here. Which is your favorite? Which one? Can you describe it? Oh, the Greece flag. Yeah. You have another favorite? Yeah. It looks like an alien ship. Are you talking about the Brazil flag there? Yeah, it does kind of look like an alien ship, doesn't it? If there are any Star Wars fans in here, it kind of looks like the Death Star, right? Yeah. Wow. So the reason that we have all of these flags up today and the reason that you see bread and juice on the table is that we are going to celebrate World Communion Sunday. And that means that everyone that's a Christian around the world, hopefully, is participating with us as we receive the bread and the cup. And it's meant as this giant symbol of unity for all of us, that even though we all worship in our own churches in different areas of the country, different areas of the world, we're actually all together with the same Spirit. And so when we take the bread, you can think about all of these people from all of these different nations and nations that aren't even represented here, eating bread with you. And when you drink the cup today, you can think about all of these people drinking the cup along with you. And it's this giant symbol of unity in a world, I think, that needs unity. We're going to talk more about unity in the sermon today, and I want you to listen really closely to what we have to say to that. Let's pray. Good and loving God, thank you for flags. God, thank you for the art that is built into them. God, thank you for all of the people that are represented here and all the people that aren't represented. God, thank you for days like World Communion Sunday, where we are reminded that we are many parts, but one body. And that, God, we share the same Spirit in your Son, Christ Jesus. Lord, help us to remember that there should be no division among us. And please nourish our spirits with the words we hear today and the food that we eat. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Sweet hour of prayer,
Well, I have to confess something. I lived with a man from South Korea for 3 years in seminary, and we actually had the South Korean flag hanging up on our wall. And so if he's watching Midim, I do apologize for messing that up. I'm very embarrassed. He will get a kick out of that. Our text today comes to us from 1 Corinthians 12, and I want you to know that I have taken some liberties with this text. I've tried to remove Paul's rhetorical devices in an effort to strip it down to the sayings. And I can talk to you more about that process if you're interested, but I invite you just to listen for the word of the Lord. There are many parts, but one body. The eye can't say to the hand, I don't need you. Nor can the head say to the foot, I don't need you. The parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. The parts we consider less honorable, we treat with greater honor. Our unpresentable parts are treated with much modesty, whereas our presentable parts have no such need. God has composed the body and has given greater honor to the parts that lacked it. So there should be no division in the body. Its members should have mutual concern for one another. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. This is God's word to us. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Good and loving God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the unity that you have given us. We thank you for gathering us together. God, I pray that whatever words we would hear this morning would come from you and not from me. In Jesus' name, amen. So the other day I was walking my dogs, enjoying this beautiful fall weather, which it's just perfect in Michigan right now. This is, wow, it's been 70, sunny, with a light breeze in the evening. I love it. So I was taking advantage of that. I was walking the dogs, and actually I had quite a bit on my mind coming back from vacation and just thinking about things and just was feeling a heaviness. And so as I'm walking, I turned the corner. I didn't get like but one block, and this woman started shouting at me and kind of flagging me down. And so I stopped and started to talk to her. And she asked me, she said, "Would you mind if I told you about the best local politician you could ever vote for in the history of this city's elections?" And to avoid the awkwardness and maybe to avoid some of the conflict, I said, "Yeah, sure." So she begins to give me the talking points that I'm sure she's given to thousands of people around the city. She's telling me how this local politician is so wonderful and so great, and she's telling me, you know, what points he's really going to focus on, and all of these things that this local politician was going to do. And I was listening kind of half-heartedly and feeling a little bit distracted. And when she got done with the end of her speech and kind of pitching me on this politician, she asked me, "What's your name and what do you do?" This is always a fun moment for pastors. Like, do you tell people what you do? Do you hide it? Sometimes it can create an awkwardness. People feel almost instantly guilty sometimes when they find out you're a pastor, as if we know every bad thing that anyone has ever done, right? And as if we've never done anything wrong ourselves. So I told her, "My name's Pastor Garrett," which is always an awkward thing to say because my first name is not Pastor and my last name's not Garrett, but that's how it comes out sometimes. And she said, "Oh, well, which church do you work for?" I said, "I'm at Fort Street downtown." And she said, "Is that the castle on 3rd? And I said, "Yeah, that's the castle right on 3rd. And then she did something really strange. She kind of stepped near me, and she held out her hands like this. And I took her hands in the middle of a pandemic, not thinking. And I got dog leashes in one hand, and she squeezes my hands really tight. And she looks me in the eyes and just stares. And then she says, "I feel your spirit. I feel your spirit." Now, for a while, I was thinking, what does that mean? I don't know what that means necessarily, but as I'm thinking that, and she's holding my hands, and she's smiling at me, and she's speaking this word to me, I feel what she's trying to say to me. I don't have any evidence for that other than I was feeling a heaviness when I began that walk, and when she spoke that to me, I felt something lifted, and I started smiling. And then she dropped my hands, and she said, "Bless you, Pastor." And then she kept on doing what she was doing. Her words changed me in a very real way, in a very tangible way. I went from feeling this weight to feeling lighter and smiling. And actually, right after she left, I started running with the dogs. I thought I was just going to walk, but I had all of this energy. And she did that with a gesture, with a touch, but mostly, I think, with a word. Haven't we all felt that before? Have you all ever had a word spoken to you and you felt sort of the change? And I'm not talking about a cheap and rehearsed compliment that someone might pay you. I'm talking about someone stopping you in the middle of the street, maybe grabbing your hands and looking you in the eye and saying something meaningful. Maybe you had a mentor or a coach growing up that really spoke words of encouragement to you, or told you not to be so hard on yourself, or just lifted you up in ways that made you feel good. Maybe you have family members that say, I love you, say, I'm proud of you. Maybe you have good friends that do that. We've all sort of felt this deep affirmation before, haven't we? At least, I hope we have. We know the power of a good word. I think we also know the opposite too, don't we? We know how a word can very quickly make us feel hurt. I was taught growing up, and I don't know how I feel about this anymore, but did anyone hear the phrase, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never harm me? I do not think that that is true. I don't think that that's true at all, because you know how a word can hurt you. You know how that feels. We all know the goodness. We all know the evil that can come out of our mouth. And we know the effect that it has on the world, but I think sometimes we forget. There's a proverb that says something like, I'm going to butcher it here, but it's something like, the fruits of the tongue are life and death. The fruits of the tongue are life and death. And I think the writer of that proverb, or the writers of that proverb, are trying to tell us that everything that comes out of our mouth is going to create or destroy. It's going to raise or it's going to bury. It's going to have an effect on the world, whether we like it or not. In our text for today, I think that Paul is asking a pretty deep question. And he asks it throughout several of his letters and several of the books in the New Testament. And that question is, and I'm kind of guessing here, but it's something like, what does it mean that we're all interconnected? And he's asking this question in a world that's actually incredibly divided. You remember he talks a lot about, you know, there's no longer Jew nor Greek. There's no longer slave nor free. There's only one body in Christ Jesus. We're all part of one spirit. He's constantly trying to bring people together and gather them and make sure that there isn't division among those that have to live together. It might be one of his chief concerns throughout his writings. How do we get people to be unified, and what does it mean that we are already unified whether we like it or not? Whether you agree or not that we're connected, we're sort of stuck together. We are bound together. And Paul really wants to answer this. I think one way of answering it, and what I hear Paul saying throughout the passage that we read today, is that being interconnected, being bound together, means that the deepest... how do I want to say this? It means that at the core of our relationships, if you suffer, any one of you out there, it actually means that I experience some suffering too. And he says that if one part suffers, the other parts suffer along with it. But if you are lifted up, if you are honored, we all get to rejoice. And we know this is true in some ways. Have you ever been in a classroom where there's like one disruptive student and the teacher is upset with that one student and it kind of ruins things for everyone? I heard someone say to me this morning that they have a rule with their children that if one of them doesn't listen, they all experience the effects of that, right? If you've ever stubbed your toe, you know how bad it can hurt. Or if you've ever had a sore tooth, a toothache, can really ruin your day. I used to get jammed fingers when I played basketball a lot, and it would just affect everything. The tiniest little thing can affect the whole body, but I don't know how often we see that relationally. I don't know how often we pay attention to it in our day-to-day lives. If one of us suffers, the rest of us suffer. To be interconnected means that actually we have an effect on those that are around us. And as I was studying that scripture this week and really thinking about it, I thought, you know, that might begin with our speech. The way we affect one another might begin with just our words. The way we say hi to someone. The way we say goodbye to someone. The way we name things that are around us. The way we speak about people, places, certain events, all of these things have an effect. Y'all have heard how politicians are speaking to one another now, haven't you? I hear it's really nothing new. I guess politicians have kind of been doing this in our country for a while, this inflamed rhetoric, this rhetoric that tears down and doesn't build up, these hate campaigns. I think as of 2019, Pew had run a poll and asked Americans all over the country, how do you feel about political rhetoric? And it was more than eight in 10 said, it's gone downhill. It's become more evil. It's become more destructive. It's become a little more, I would say, evil. More than 8 in 10 people thought that, which I found fascinating. And if you think about it, or you're beginning to disagree, I would say, you know, we actually saw the effects. If you just think about the last 4 or 5 years of the political climate, you can actually see the power that words have to motivate people to do certain things, right? We saw the effects of a major politician standing in a place of power and speaking evil, hateful, unthoughtful words to the masses, and then we saw how the masses responded to that, right? And that's kind of an extreme example, but I think it also happens on these micro levels. But just take that one. You saw that speech from a place of prominence does have an effect on the world. I'm preaching to myself here because I get a place of semi-prominence every other week. Our words matter. You've seen the effects that bad speech patterns have had on the world, and we saw it culminate in the storming of the Capitol. If you're like me, you can see that negativity pretty easily. And social media, the news, they make it easy. They sort of feed on that bad news, I would call it, that bad rhetoric. But actually, what I hear Paul saying too, and the thing that I think we don't always focus on, is the potential for life in our words as well. We let those negative voices, we let that evil rhetoric sort of take over and distract us from the other side of the truth. And that is, your words have the power to create. They have the power to build people up. They have the power to make the world into a better place. But we forget it. We forget it. You can help change the world by the way you speak to others. The way you represent yourself on social media, what you post, can have an effect on the world, or I should say will have an effect on the world. The way you ask for something, the way you say I love you or I'm sorry, the way you confront and challenge others, the news you choose to read, digest, and then share with the world. Our words, whether we like it or not, are going to bring life or death. And I want you to see this morning how much power you actually have. I want you to try something with me this week. I'm sort of inspired by this woman that stopped me on the street and spoke this word to me, but I thought, you know, I never do that with people. That's not really my style. I don't know if I will ever do that, but I want us to practice something together. There is so much bad news out there. There is so much negativity. There is so much hateful speech. There is so much misinformation, disinformation. There is so much going on out there that I truly believe that one way that we can begin to heal the world is by speaking good words, by preaching good news. And I want you to try that with me this week. Pay attention to what you say to others. Pay attention to emails you write. Let's pay attention to the way we talk to those closest to us. And just notice what comes out. Is it mostly negative? Is it lifting them up, or is it not? Is it creating life? Is it honoring people? I just want you to pay attention, because I think if we can bring out an awareness to the potential we have with our words, we can begin to use our words more wisely, more strategically. And I think that this is what Paul is actually asking of us, to think deeply about how we are connected, to think deeply about the effects that we have on one another, and to honor those people that we find dishonorable, to lift up those that are considered weak by society, to bring justice into the world, just by the way you speak. We would all do well to remember that our words matter. They have power. I want you to think twice this week before you post or share something. Think twice about what you may say in the heat of the moment. I'd like to invite us to pause this week to measure our sentences, to strive to create a new world with our words, just like God spoke this earth into being. Our words are a gift from God. They're a way for us to heal our neighbors. They're a way for us to reconcile with our enemies. They are a way to end suffering in the world. Friends, our words matter. My words matter. And they're just sitting in our mouths with all of this creative or destructive potential. And I invite you this week to think about them and to think about the call that Jesus places on all of our lives to go into the ends of the earth and to spread good news. Let's pray. Good and loving God, thank you for our words. Thank you for the power that they have. God, I pray that we would pay more attention to that, that we would use our words wisely to bring your kingdom to earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
The heavens and the earth, the sun and moon and stars, the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, all things belong to God. And to God all things return. At this time, we have a moment to give back to God with joy our offerings, our gifts, our time, our skills, and to remember that it always belonged to God in the first place. I'd like to invite our ushers to collect our tithes and offerings. God, you have entrusted us with the works of your own hands. Now we return these gifts to you with thanksgiving and praise. Use them for all your glory and for the good of your world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. As Pastor Garrett mentioned earlier, today is World Communion Sunday. And on this day, we are invited to gather around this table here, remembering all of those who are gathering around other tables elsewhere. This is not Fort Street's table. It's not a table that belongs to the Presbyterian Church or to the United States of America or to any one person or group. This is a table that belongs to Jesus Christ, and all who put their trust in him are invited and welcome. On World Communion Sunday, we and thousands of other Christians around the world gather to celebrate the Lord's Supper. We're reminded that this table stretches beyond borders, beyond walls. We gather with Christians around the world who celebrate in Palestine, in Colombia. We gather with Syrians and Guatemalans and Germans and Kenyans and people who have no nation identity. This table does not ask for citizenship status nor any other kind of documentation. This is a table where all the languages of our lips and our hearts are spoken and understood. This is a table where there is no room for weapons or hatred, but is ever extending to make more room for anyone who seeks a place.
Let's pray. Creating God, source of our being, we give you thanks and praise, for you have brought forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. In the beginning, you created people in your likeness. In your likeness, you created people who multiplied and became many, people of many races, nationalities, genders, and abilities. You created the world and all that is in it without borders or walls, and you called it good. For this we praise you. Jesus, our sibling, born of Mary in a stable in Palestine, you confronted the powers and principalities of your time and welcomed as your friends those whose society had cast aside. For love and liberation of your people, you risked your life and were executed by the brokenness of empire. Yet even death could not put an end to the love you embodied. Out of death, you arose to new life, to live again among your people. With joy, we celebrate what you have done, and with dedication, we follow you, transformed by your love, as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Boundless God, pour out your Spirit on this bread, in this cup, and these people. Through these ordinary gifts that sustain our bodies, nourish us and transform us, that we might remember that we belong to each other and to you. Through this remembering, let us be reconciled to each other and you. Through this remembering, may we tear down all boundaries and walls that we have built. And through this remembering, may all peoples and all places and times be united in you as we share this meal and pray the words that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night that he was arrested by the authorities, Jesus was gathered in an upper room with his closest friends to celebrate the Passover, a story of liberation. And as they gathered, he took a piece of bread, blessed it, and broke it. As he gave it to them, he said, "Take and eat. Every time you do this, do it in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the meal, he took and poured the cup. Giving it to his disciples, he said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant. Every time you take it, remember me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup still today, we do so in remembrance of Jesus Christ. We proclaim the unity and the good news as we wait for his return. This morning, as we celebrate, we invite you to look at the flags around you and to imagine all those who are gathered in the same way today. Pastor Garrett mentioned somehow the sanctuary feels smaller, almost cozy with these flags here, doesn't it? And it's this reminder that we are surrounded by people much bigger than ourselves within our own four walls. As we partake of this feast, let's remember that unity. Today, you'll have an option to partake in a couple of different ways. We have servers that will give little pieces of bread and small cups of juice. If you feel more comfortable, we also have the pre-packaged variety, so you could take one of those, however you feel most comfortable to participate. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks.
Invite the ushers to come forward.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Oh God, our mystery, you bring us to life, and call us to freedom, and move between us with love. Having been nourished at your table, may we go into our wondrous and diverse world to tear down walls of exclusion, to confront powers and principalities, to live and love boldly in the promise of your resurrection. Amen.
You may be seated. Two opportunities that we would like to invite you into this morning. The first is a great adult education series that will begin next week. This is taught by two of Fort Street's own, Craig and Kathy, and the class that they are teaching is called Five Loaves, Two Fish, and 12 Steps. They will be looking through Richard Rohr's amazing book, Breathing Underwater, Spirituality and the 12 Steps. This isn't just for folks struggling with addiction. It invites us all into a place where we look at the beauty of the intentionality of 12 Steps and the connection that has to spirituality. They will be inviting you to look at the book as we prepare for the class. Again, the book is from Richard Rohr, and it's called Breathing Underwater. And so we invite you, if you'd like to participate, to purchase the book. If you would like help with that, or if you need to borrow one, we have a few at the church here as well. And know that you're invited to, even if you don't do the reading. You're always welcome to come and join in the conversation. You won't be lost. But they will start next week looking at the first two steps of Richard Rohr's book. So feel free to get more information through Craig or Kathy or ask us online. They did want us to note that there is a workbook that is different from the actual book. So if you're purchasing, look for the actual book and join us for that adult education series here in the Great Hall at 9:45 starting next week. And as a side note to that, we will have 1 week of that class, but then October 17th, we will not meet for adult education or for worship because the Detroit Marathon will be happening on October 17th, 2 weeks from today. The streets will all be blocked, so even if you try to come to church, you'll realize you can't make it anyway, so save yourself some time and stay at home. We will have a service that we will be broadcasting on Facebook and our regular channels. So you can still worship with us, but worship with us from home on the 17th.
Yeah. Many of you have been asking me, Pastor Garrett, can we do church more often? And so the answer is actually yes. Today we're gonna have a second service for all of you that have been wanting more church. And extra blessings to those of you that come for the second part of this doubleheader. So Sarah and I are being installed as Fort Street's pastors today. And if you are not familiar with the installation process, it is a ceremony that honors and marks the beginning of a ministry. Now, we've already been here for a year, but you know, it was a kind of a different and weird year. And so we're just now getting to the point where we can come together and celebrate in person to install us and to mark the beginning of our times here. And so we want to invite you all back to that. That's at 4 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. Well, friends, as you go, may you know that you have the power of life and death sitting on the tip of your tongue. And may you know, too, that God is looking down upon you, smiling at you. May you know that you are loved and that your life truly matters. Amen.